Family Matters. I'm Dr. Kathleen Smith. No family is free of conflict, but some families experience more intense conflict than others. Researchers often attribute family chaos or violence to personality traits or situational factors. But if a person can look beyond the individual to the larger relationship system, they might begin to think differently about a family that fights. In this edition of Family Matters, I'll talk with Amie Post about how Bowen theory offers a different framework for thinking about high-conflict families. We'll discuss how conflict and violence are often the output of a relationship system that is trying to adapt to life's challenges. Amie Post is a licensed marriage and family therapist and a faculty member at the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family. She's also the executive director at the Family Crisis Center of Baltimore County, a domestic violence service provider. Amie, welcome to Family Matters.
Thanks, Kathleen. I'm glad to be here.
Yeah. So can we just get started with you sharing a little bit about what you think about with the term, you know, a family that fights or a chaotic family?
Yeah, I think what I'd want to start by saying is it's never okay in my mind for someone to harm another person. After that kind of gets established, what I start to think about is how do families relate to one another over time. And I think when tensions start to get high, one way individuals manage that tension in the relationship system is to try and engage or control the other. It can end up in being kind of my way or the highway. It can get into I perceive threat and therefore I'm going to try and tamp down what I experience as threat. Some families get into cycles where their response to any sense of threat is always to fight with one another. Other families, when they start to feel threat, fight, calm down, back away, maybe talk about it with someone else. Sometimes they go and have other ways of calming themselves down, some useful, others not. Some of the families I think about are families who are up against it in so many ways. They are faced with the challenges of daily living. They're constrained by not having adequate housing, not having access to employment, not being exposed to sufficient educational processes. And as they are more and more up against it, they look to their partner to calm them down, to soothe them when they're upset, to kind of begin to create an environment at home or in their relationship that will be less stressful. I think when the expectation shifts that somehow the other is responsible for calming is when conflict and violence can erupt.
Okay, so it sounds like a response to anxiety or fear or threat. That sounds a little bit different than what a lot of people describe as, oh, well, that's just the personality of my family, or that's how this individual is. They like to fight, or that's just how they interact with other humans. That sounds like a little bit of a different way of thinking about it.
I think it can be a both and. Okay. That it is a family's pattern for kind of managing the challenge over time. And there are probably preferred ways that families develop to manage these kind of things. And there are personalities that tend to be more engaging toward conflict and other personalities that tend to kind of scoot back. The degree to which the family, the relationship process is really kind of going at these things with any level of intensity is about the emotional process in the family.
Okay. So what could be useful for a person who is observing this process happening in their family and they feel overwhelmed or hopeless about changing it? You know, what do they do?
Yeah, I was thinking with some of the couples that I've had the privilege of working with, both individuals in the couple would look to the other person as needing to change how they are. And that's true to an extent. But I think what changes is basically how does one respond to the stimulus the other's sending? So a guy and a gal I'm working with, and these are couples that are not at the point of violence or harming one another. That's kind of a special category. Before that level kind of emerges, it's like me with my partner, and I would suspect anyone with anybody else's partner. Sure. There are times where conflict emerges, and it's often because I think you are responsible for helping me get my needs met. and I'm frustrated and I'm upset and I feel threatened when my needs aren't being met, and so I try and come in and correct your behavior to get the outcome I'm seeking. To get off of that merry-go-round, for me anyway, has been a series of steps to think about me recalibrating the types of decisions about who's responsible for what. Working with couples in this situation, the shift would be beyond how do you want your environment to change to how would you like to change how you respond to your environment. And if conflict's not working for you, what other ways are available to you?
Okay. Well, it sounds like that could be difficult for a person to stop focusing so much on their partner or the other person in the family and to think about how they respond. It doesn't sound like it's very easy.
No, I think it's super counterintuitive. And I think it's hard too, because it's so easy to look at the problem as being something from the individual. It's much, much harder to see the problem emerging because of a bunch of dance steps that both people, and in fact, kind of the whole family emotional system, are in this kind of dance of the jitterbug, mm-hmm. that everybody is contributing to it. Mm-hmm. What I think the kind of the fun promise of Bowen theory is that if any one person can start to change their dance steps and listen to a different kind of music in the background, the rest of the system's gonna change around it. Mm-hmm. But it is a paradox, and I think it's real hard to get to the space where you can calm you're upset long enough to begin to think about it a little bit differently.
Well, speaking of that, one of the things that I notice with people sometimes is that they start to think about themselves and to calm down a little bit, but they assume that the change in everyone else will be very quick. You know, if I could just abstain from one fight or sound rational for 30 seconds, then everyone else will fall in place, right? But that's not the case, right? There can be some pushback, or the conflict is not necessarily gonna die down right away.
Sure, because if you shift from seeing conflict as being something about content to conflict being a process that this family is using to kind of navigate the challenges of day-to-day life, then changing how conflict gets utilized is less about sustaining change around a particular issue, and it's more about sustaining change in a relationship process. And those kind of changes are not something that kind of emerged in one day or overnight, and they're not going to emerge or become real overnight on the other side of it. Right. These are seeds that have been growing in the relationship process for generations.
Well, I think that's an interesting point about conflict not being about the issues. Could you speak a little bit more
sure.
about that?
I was trying to think about watching a family in a good conflict where, assuming all things being equal, both members are safe. But the conflict is often, you could insert a variety of content areas. I'm upset because you did not meet my needs. And then you could fill in what those needs were. It's less about what happened and when it happened, and it's more about how one person was making another person responsible for their sense of well-being. Sometimes it's about the toothpaste. Sometimes it's about moving the accoutrements of the bathroom counter from my side to your side. Other times it's more important about who's spending money when and on what. But the idea of taking a different kind of responsibility for how you'll participate in the relationship seems to be the pathway out of those cycles of conflict.
Okay. So negotiating a solution on one particular issue or problem doesn't mean that conflict won't emerge in other areas.
For sure. I feel like a lot of time can be spent negotiating solutions and feeling like that's the resolution of conflict, whereas work on self and developing a different way of engaging, kind of both relating to others and being clear on who you are and where you're trying to go, mm-hmm. the different types of content become easier to navigate.
Okay. Well, then if a person is thinking about working on themselves and you're working with a family that's fighting, does the whole family need to be present and thinking about that? Is it useful to have more than one person in the room, or do you just need one person?
I think the work can happen with just one person. I like a good opportunity because I think if you're in a space where the family is moving quickly through the process, folks may be able to see it differently. But the work can happen probably most effectively and most efficiently when one person starts to take a different level of responsibility for it.
Okay. Well, one thing I hear commonly from people is, you know, we just need to work on our communication skills, right? I mean, is that a part of you sort of reducing conflict in a family? Is that a distraction or from the way you think about it? Or what would you say when people bring that idea to you as a potential solution?
I think the question I would ask is, where does the skill development kind of aim its output?
Okay.
So if the reason that you're working on having better communication skills is to have a better relationship, that's different than working on having effective communication skills so you can better define what you're thinking and take responsibility for how you are explaining that to others.
Okay.
I think, again, it's how do you express your needs better? Well, is the expression of needs because you want the other person to better able meet them, or because you're trying to articulate how those are existing in you and the steps you're going to take to try and meet your own needs and invite your partner to be a part of that or not?
Okay. So it sounds like a little bit of work on the front end is, to say a confusing phrase, thinking about your own thinking and the process versus the communication piece with the other person.
For sure.
Yeah.
I think learning communication skills, learning how to relate to one another, kind of developing shared spaces, for all of us, it feels much better when we are aligned with someone more closely and we exist in a we. It's a little scarier, I think, to begin to exist as an individual, and it challenges the status quo that most of us oriented our relationships around. That work takes a bit of courage and a little bit of stamina to persist in it.
It doesn't sound like it's fast work.
I think it can have fast outputs, but sustainable outcomes take a lifetime of effort. And it's probably not just in your relationship with your partner, but it's in your relationship with your parents and your siblings and your extended family.
Okay. Well, can you think of an example either with yourself or a family that you've worked with, a sort of one person's individual efforts in thinking about their part in the family conflict, how that was useful for them? Or
yeah, I was thinking about this couple that I met, and that they had been through work with a series of relationship counselors, and they had really learned all of the great skills about how to communicate their needs. They had learned how to be emotionally present to one another. They had spent some energy on being 100% accountable and present to the other person. And they were really frustrated because nothing was changing. One of the fascinating things was the wife started to come in and meet individually and started to think about how often in the day-to-day was she turning to her partner and asking them to meet her needs. And what she noticed is that every time she became upset, she turned to the partner and said, "This needs to be done." And the partner would push back and say, "Well, I don't have time to do it right now." And the wife would say, "I want you to do it right now because I'm upset." And the partner would push back, and from there the conflict would emerge. As this person started to be able to identify the part she was playing in it and start to creatively experiment with playing that part differently, what's really, really interesting is that initially the conflict got more intense.
Okay.
And the partner said, "Wait a minute, don't you need me anymore? Don't you love me? I used to play such an important role." The shift in kind of taking the intensity out of the relationship process is probably the hardest work. As this person kept persisting in her own thinking about what she wanted to be responsible for differently, after the initial intensification of conflict happened, this couple started to enjoy life together differently. They could even get to the point where one person would say to the other, "I need you to do this for me." And the other person would say, "Is that a real need or a perceived need?"
That's great.
They would laugh.
Right.
And then they would say, we could choose to continue as if we have before. Would you like the script?
That's really interesting.
It's quite fascinating.
So it sounds like the, from what I was hearing about the conflict, it was sort of the message of, I can't calm down until you do X. You are responsible for how anxious I am or how I am upset I am.
And so. Right. And if you asked any grown-up on any given occasion, are you really so dependent on your environment that you can't stay calm if things don't go a certain way? Most of us would say, oh, no, I'm not. Mm-hmm. Then the fun opportunity is to think about, well, how do you live that way authentically?
Okay. Well, I'm thinking about people sort of who are in the midst of it in their own immediate or nuclear family. And, you know, the idea that going back a generation or two can be useful in helping them think about their own functioning. Is that something that you do with people or ask them to think about observing or thinking about how conflict has played a role in previous generations?
Yeah. So I kind of think about sometimes the stuff that we're doing today worked really, really well in a previous generation, and it gets kind of remembered as a way of managing stuff today because it's faster to remember it than to think through it on our own. This same couple started to think about how had conflict been showing up in previous generations. And one of the things that came forward was that in the generation before them, in their parents' generation, there actually was never conflict. They existed in kind of a like, let's keep peace at all costs. And this woman remembered her mom saying that she just never felt like she could say anything. And she felt kind of impinged by this idea that she had to just keep peace. This woman made it her vow that she was not going to be like her mom, and she was going to say what she needed to say when she needed to say it. When she continued to explore kind of the generation above that, so in her grandmother's generation, she learned that in fact that marriage had been so contentious that her own mother had grown up in the middle of chaos, and it had made her own vow that I'll never be like my mom. And so instead of fighting, right, I'm going to keep peace at all costs. So this kind of back and forth between testing out intense versions of probably the same pattern mm-hmm. was playing into the everyday way of relating to the current partner.
That makes sense. So it was just the opposite, flipping generation yeah. to generation.
How things are being done may be very different across generations, but the intensity with which they're being used and the automaticity with which they show up is probably pretty similar.
So there's not a lot of flexibility in managing it in different ways, or
yeah, at the emotional level,
okay,
the ability to have more flexibility can increase over time.
Okay. Well, I'm thinking about maybe an individual or somebody in their family, and they say, "Well, I'm not going to participate in this conflict. I'm just going to not talk to you guys or not jump into it," and they begin to distance or sort of back away from their family as a solution for dealing with it. You know, what are the pros and cons of that approach?
Sure, a little dipping out is yeah. It always settles right. things down for a period. How long can you go without telling people what you actually think and believe before you start to feel like you don't have much of who you are in the conversation? For some families, it can be a long, long time. But when we think about relationships that are truly intimate, where each person can know kind of the thinking and the feeling and the full experiences of the other without having to run and hide or manage the other, that takes a little bit less running away and a little bit more standing still.
Okay. How does it, you know, I'm thinking a lot of conversations today where people might use the excuse, well, it's not safe for me to be in contact with my family, or, you know, how does a person, you know, imagine when you feel under threat, you're very anxious, it can be a little bit difficult to assess
yeah.
what's actually dangerous and worth, you know, promoting safety, and what's just you being annoyed by your family, right?
Yeah.
You know, how does a person kind of decipher that, or how does that play a role?
I think it takes a little bit of work to think through what's real threat, and I think it's hard to remember that no amount of feeling has ever killed any form of life. Feelings can paralyze you. Feelings can really upset you. I can't think of a real example where feelings kill you. My response to a feeling might get my heart rate all wonky. So I think being able to assess reality, safety versus perceived safety. I also wouldn't advocate like just going headlong into spaces that are upsetting to you without having a thinking plan in place for how you want to be responsible for keeping yourself safe. Mm-hmm. You could spend the rest of your life trying to change the environment to feel safer, or you could start to think about how do you want to be in a place where you could put up your own personal force fields mm-hmm. to protect yourself regardless of the environment.
Okay, that's useful. Thanks. The example, one of the examples that you gave was between, I'm assuming spouses or romantic partners, but I imagine you can, a person can work on this in it with any member of their family or people outside of their families. Is it more useful to work on it in a marriage? Is it more useful to work on it with your parents or siblings?
Yes. I mean, I think it's useful to work on it across all of the relationships okay. because the one thing that remains constant is you. In the relationship system. So regardless of how the relationship is organized, you can use each of these relationship partners as a place to kind of experiment with how you want to be more responsible for managing yourself. It might be really, really hard to change these patterns with someone you're intimately involved with. You might have a little more room to practice these skills to manage self in a work relationship. And then I think it might be kind of fun to go up and work with your parents and maybe with that great aunt that everybody finds really cantankerous. Mm-hmm. What would it take for you to stay engaged in that a little bit more neutrally without having to run away from it or try and correct it?
Okay, so it sounds like there are multiple opportunities.
Yeah, always and forever when you start to think about yeah. this as a system.
Yeah. One thing about people who, you know, have children and they're thinking of the next generation and they say, you know, my family fought a lot, things were very chaotic, and you know, I don't want my kids to grow up in that kind of family. Or you gave the example of the woman just doing the opposite, right? But if people are thinking sort of, you know, the next generation coming up in their family, what are some things that are useful for them to begin to think about or actions they can take to sort of have a more flexible family when challenges come up or stressful things happen?
I think, I kind of think about conflict in and of itself isn't bad. So I kind of get curious about what is it, when is it useful to be able to have kind of conflict emerge? When do you really want to hold a spot and be willing to defend it? Or maybe even promote it in order to make sure a real need is met. So not thinking about how any one way of being is good or bad, but how does the way of being get used based on the reality needs of the day-to-day operating?
Okay. So tell me if I'm hearing this wrong, but it sounds like it's also, is this just an automatic thing that happens
right.
when we're all stressed out, or is this a conscious choice or a thoughtful choice
right.
for how to approach a problem or how to solve a problem?
Yeah, can you get a heartbeat's worth of space between the thing that is upsetting to you and your response to it? And in that heartbeat's worth of space, can you ask yourself, is this the best time to be conflictual? Is that going to help me move toward my bigger goal?
I mean, I'm really curious. Can you give me an example of where, because it's hard for me to get out of this headspace of conflict is bad, right?
Yeah.
You know, can you think of an example where conflict was useful or helped a family or a group of people sort of tackle
yeah.
a problem or manage a problem?
I think it was actually really adaptive in a family I know pretty well, which is, the parents had really different ideas about how to best proceed for one of their kids launching to college. And they needed to work through that difference of ideas. And the conflict wasn't about trying to convince the other person, but it was kind of intensely holding positions. Mm-hmm. So you have two grown-ups, both think pretty clearly. Both have really well thought out positions, but they're quite different. And the tension in this family got held up in the conflict between the parents. It was quite adaptive because the kid leaving for college left without quite so much worry. Mm-hmm. The parents were so busy kind of holding the back and forth about what the right way to do this, that the kid kind of scooted out without so much shared worry from the parents.
Okay. So it sounds like I'm hearing, you know, that it sometimes it is okay to bring a grievance or a disagreement to a partner or another family member.
I would say always okay. It's okay to do that.
Okay. It's not always just about, oh, I just need to be responsible for myself and
no,
and back
it's
off.
I think mature people are able to kind of communicate what they're thinking. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that may result in a back and forth that I would say probably feels conflictual more than it is aggressively conflict. And that might be a nuance.
Okay.
But conflict itself, I wouldn't say is inherently evil or bad.
Well, I think that's useful to remember that conflict serves a purpose, but if you can bring your best thinking to it, you know, things have a better chance of calming down or being resolved. So
yeah.
Thank you so much for coming today. I really appreciated our conversation.
Thank you.
I'd like to remind you that the Bowen Center offers both in-person and online training for clinicians, clergy members, business leaders, and others who want to learn more about Bowen theory. We also offer affordable psychotherapy to those in the Washington, D.C. area. If you'd like more information about our topic or the Bowen Center, you can visit our website at www.thebowencenter.org or send me an email at familymatters@thebowencenter.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter, or call us at 202-965-4400. Thank you for watching. I invite you to join me next time for another edition of Family Matters. I'm Dr. Kathleen Smith, and your family does matter.